This is what it's all about right here. I know you can't wait to get your hands in those bees. Especially the nice lady who just came up and asked me, how do I know if I'm allergic to bees? Well, there's one way to find out, for sure. And hopefully you're not. If it turns out you are, this is probably not the hobby for you, because you are gonna get stung at some point. Hopefully not too often. We'll do everything we can to minimize that, but it's just kind of one of those facts of life. If you're gonna work on a car engine, you're gonna get grease on your fingers. If you're gonna work in the garden, you're gonna get dirt under your fingernails. If you're gonna work with the bees, eventually, you're probably gonna take a sting. But people ask me, will always ask you, do you ever get stung? So get used to that question. And then they follow that up with, do you ever get used to it? No, you never do. It always comes as a surprise. You're never expecting it, but it's one of those things. So I hope that maybe you've considered reading up on honeybees a little bit. Hopefully you did that before you came to class. You know, there's a lot of good references out there. Your handout from last week had some recommended books that I like. It's good to have a couple of them around. They all pretty much say the same things in a little bit different ways. Sometimes one book will make more sense than another, but good to have a reference book. You may not sit down and read it cover to cover more than once anyway, but it's good to be able to refer back to things, and it's good to get different people's opinions on it. Of course, if you haven't already purchased your beehives and other equipment, then that's something that you need to get going, because bees will be ready soon, and we don't want them to be homeless. So you want to make sure that you've got all your frames together, foundation in, all your hives together, make sure it's painted, all the stuff that we talked about last week. And of course, if you haven't ordered bees yet, there's still time, maybe. For a lot of you, if you're getting them here locally, they should be in a couple of weeks. If you haven't, you might still be able to find some places you can order them from. Pretty soon though, all the early bees are gonna be gone. You may have to wait until May, even June, in order to get your honeybees delivered. So they are in high demand, and they can be in short supply in the springtime. Whether you want one beehive or you want a dozen or more, you need to think about where you're gonna put those bees. So plan your apiary site. Placing beehives does require a little bit of forethought, because once the bees are established in the hives, you can move them around, but it takes a little bit of knowledge to do that, because every one of these hives here, the bees inside know where they live. They orient on that location. Their first day out of the hive, they do what's called an orientation flight. They make little circles, wider and wider, taking in all the landmarks around them. They know that this is where they came out from. It's between those hives, and they look at the trees, the buildings, everything else, and then they'll take off and go far away, but when they come back, they can find that one spot. So as long as we don't move them too far, they always come back home. Your bees need various things. I should say there's ideal situations for your bees and what they need. So if we understand what bees really want, what makes them happy, what keeps them healthy, then it'll help you to choose a spot. Now there's maybe an ideal, not every site is gonna have all of those things, but you know, get as close as you can. Of course, your bees want dependable nectar sources. We want our bees to have dependable nectar sources, because that's more honey for us, and more honey for our bees, of course. Unless you have thousands of acres you're willing to plant, that's not something that we necessarily need to worry about, because our bees are gonna forage in a very large area around our apiary, and they're gonna find what they want, they're gonna find what they need, they're gonna bring back that pollen and nectar. Bees do need a good water source. Plenty of water out right now, but in the hot summertime, some of those sources may dry up. You wanna make sure that you provide bees with water if they need it. So if you don't have a natural source within a quarter mile or closer, then you might want to supply them with some water. We'll talk about that more in a minute. You can have too much water. There's too much of a good thing there. And I actually had some bees out by the river in 2019 when that whole area flooded, and I lost several hives. I knew that the water was gonna rise, but I was not expecting it to get that high. That's not my apiary there, but I did have some that washed away and never were seen again. So you wanna make sure that you keep them high and dry. Windbreak is good. That helps your bees as they're coming in for a landing. A heavy crosswind makes it difficult for them to be able to come and go. And in the wintertime, If you can block that cold north wind coming in, then that's gonna help your hives to be able to stay a little bit warmer. So if you have your bees next to a building or a wooden fence or something like that, then maybe you're blocking that wind already. If you have your bees in the middle of a pasture, it's wide open and there's a lot of wind, you might consider setting something up around them, especially in the wintertime. Our bees seem to prefer a hive that has an opening that faces the morning sun. The studies they've done have shown that even in nature, bees are moving into hollow trees. They like one that has morning sun shining on the entrance. It helps them to get up and go and get moving. So you can turn your hives to face that direction, kind of east, southeast. They seem to like that. And we recommend that we put hives in bright afternoon sun in the evening. And that's because of these darn small hive beetles. If you put your hives in the shade, then you are definitely going to have more problem with these beetles. The beetles do not like the sun, and they're out in the late afternoon, in the evening, looking for hives to invade. And if your hives have more sun, then you're going to have fewer problems with them. But hives in the shade, almost guaranteed, are going to have more hive beetles in them. And we'll talk more about those beetles in our next week's lesson. Consider your own needs as a beekeeper. You want something convenient to get to, but you also want to have plenty of space for your bees. You want them to be safe. You want your neighbors to be safe. So depending on the scale of beekeeping that you want to get into and how much space that you have available, you know, you're going to have to find something that works for you. If you've just got one hive in your backyard, you can probably find enough room for it. In some places, they keep bees on rooftops in cities. People live in apartment buildings and they don't have a yard. People keep them on balconies. This seems like a very inconvenient place to keep bees, but perhaps it's better than no bees at all. But imagine when it comes time to harvest honey and you've got to be handing frames to your friend inside the little window there. So that's probably not the best place. If you can roll right up to your beehives and in your truck or with a cart or wheelbarrow or something like that, it's going to make things a lot easier. A lot of things in beekeeping get heavy. And they're heavy when you put them on the hive, and they're even heavier when you take them off, hopefully, because they'll be full of honey. And being able to roll that right away with hundreds of pounds of honey is very convenient. If you have to walk up and down a muddy hillside carrying big boxes, sometimes two people at a time carrying boxes, it can get kind of cumbersome. So pick a spot that's got easy access. And if you're going to be putting your bees on someone else's property, you should have their permission. Believe it or not, some people don't. Sometimes beehives show up on farmland and they may have been on the wrong side of the road. Farmer says, "Whose beehives are these?" I say, "I don't know, finders keepers." But we in Arkansas, we actually have a state law. We call it the 3-mile rule. If you want to place bees on your own property, then that's always going to be approved. But if you want to put bees on someone else's property, you need permission of the other established beekeepers within 3 miles of that area. This is designed to protect the pasturage rights of beekeepers. So if I've had bees in this location for years and I'm making lots of honey, it prevents somebody from moving in 100 beehives right next door that on land that doesn't belong to them, and they're taking all of my good honey that I've been making. So if you rent a home, then of course that counts the same as owning it as far as that rule goes. If you have been asked by someone else to put bees on their land for pollination, if they've got fruit trees or a garden or a farm or something like that, all you need is a letter from the landowner that says they request that, and it's going to be approved. It's a little bit contentious. Some people don't like that rule, but it is the law. Do be aware of your neighbors. This is in particular for you urban beekeepers. You love your honeybees, but you may be living next door to someone who is not quite as keen on them as you are, believe it or not. Whether you've got one hive or you've got a dozen hives, you do want to just be on good terms with your neighbors. There is such a thing as too much of a good thing. You know, you have a bee suit, and you can put it on when you have to be around your hives, and you might be stirring them up, but your neighbors may not necessarily have that. You may like it where you can just look out your window and see your bees, but you might have somebody very nearby who is not quite as comfortable as you are with them. So, you know, just be a good neighbor. I find that a couple of jars of fresh honey straight out of the hive helps to soothe any uncomfortableness that your neighbors might have. They're a little nervous at first, but the first time they taste that fresh honey, they forget all about it, and they're glad to see you again next summer too. So keep that up. We like to put up a privacy fence around bees or some thick vegetation. This is called a flight barrier. It forces the bees to fly up and over instead of just going right across your neighbor's yard. Honeybees, once they're about 10 feet out from a hive, they're gonna be about 10 feet in the air, and they travel in what we call foraging lanes that are up overhead. And this keeps them out of our way, keeps them out of the way of everybody and most obstacles, and this is just where they tend to travel. And they'll come back down in for a landing. They're not gonna go up over a fence and right down into your neighbor's yard again, unless your neighbor's yard is full of flowers. In some cities, some municipalities, there's actually rules that require you to have a flight barrier, so you might need to look into that. And it's also just a good idea. If you hide your hive, out of sight is out of mind. You might have neighbors that don't even know you've got bees for years. They might wonder what all that smoke is coming out of your yard, but they may not know you have bees for a long time. And of course, when your neighbors are out having a barbecue, when they're out there with a bunch of 10-year-olds having a birthday party, use your common sense. That's not the time that you go out and open up hives and disturb them all and you know, rile them all up and get them in the air. You do need to follow the rules. We have rules, there are state laws about beekeeping, and those are put in place by the State Department of Agriculture, the Apiary section of the State Plant Board. You are required by state law to register the location of your bee yards, your apiaries. It's not complicated. There's a simple one-page form, and if you look on the back of tonight's handout, you can see what you've got there. They just need your contact information and the location of your apiaries. It says quarter section and township and range and all that. That's from an old record-keeping system. They don't use that really anymore. They need your latitude and longitude. You can find that on your cell phone or on Google Maps, or they can help you find it if you need to, but that's really all you need. Give it a name or a number. Just say home. If that's your only beehive, that's fine, and the other stuff is pretty obvious. It's free. So in Arkansas, this is free. In a lot of our neighboring states, there's actually a fee you have to pay to register your hives, but it is the law. You are required to do this. What happens if you don't? Well, not a whole lot, but when they find out, they'll add you to their list. It's a good idea to be registered. For one thing, you can take advantage of your state apiary inspectors. They make house calls. If you think you've got a problem in your beehive, you can't figure it out, you can call the inspector. They come to your home or your bee yard for free and go through your bees with you. They can give you advice. Do consult local regulations. So I mentioned that we have city laws, whether you live here in Little Rock, in North Little Rock, Bryant, Cabot, Conway. I know a lot of y'all are from different places. You can look up city codes online. Pretty much all of them are online now. They're searchable. Look up honey, look up bee, and look up honeybee as one word, because technically it's two words, but a lot of people misspell it as one word. So search for that. If you can't find any reference to honeybee laws in your town, don't tell anybody, because if you call up the courthouse and ask what the rules are about honeybees, they'll look and they'll see that there's not any, and by golly, the next time there's a city council meeting, somebody will propose one. So don't be that guy. If you are members of a property owners association, a homeowners association, they also have their own rules and charters, and you can look through that and make sure that there's not anything that you need to worry about there. Sometimes those rules are very vague. They just say no dangerous animals. So they can apply that to alligators and pit bulls and Rottweiler farms, but somebody might apply that to honeybees too, so just be aware.